A legend is a descriptive statement that accompanies a table or figure. So let me ask you, in a table, where is the legend positioned? Is it on top or below? A legend for a table is usually on top, and a legend for a figure is usually at the bottom. That is the standard way of doing things. It can't be the other way around. And do not give numbers or percentages that imply greater accuracy than the methods used. Meaning that, for example, your measurements were up to one decimal point. Because SPSS or Stata or APINFO can give you 5 decimal points, then you include 5 decimal points. That's not right. Because the order of accuracy from your research instrument was up to 1 decimal point. And therefore, you only include 1 decimal point. If you are using any materials that are supposed to be borrowed from any copyright holder, you are supposed to request for permission. By this we mean, for example, you want to quote the entire paragraph. You cannot quote the entire paragraph, verbatim as it is, without asking for permission, because people have copyrights. The moment you publish your paper, it no longer belongs to you. It belongs to the publisher. Somebody was asking me, I have done all this work myself. I have gone out in the field, slept, being bitten by mosquitoes. I collect this information. I come back, I write. I spend sleepless nights developing the paper. Then after the paper is published, it no longer belongs to me. It belongs to the publisher. Then somebody was saying, this is not right. But it's just an agreement that the moment you publish your work, it no longer belongs to you. And therefore, if you want to use that information, you must request for permission from the responsible individuals who are the copyright owners of that information. Provide working titles, abstracts, and tables. Of course, in the beginning, you had developed an abstract, but now we are assuming that you are becoming more serious, coming up with something substantial, an abstract that is good. Now, these other slides that are going to follow, they are redundant because we are assuming at this stage you will have started using the software for referencing. Which software do you use for referencing? Mendeley. So we are assuming that you have started using Mendeley, and all this business of deciding which format you're going to use does not hold any water, because you can decide to change any time. Because you can just change to any format you wish according to the journal that you are sending your manuscript. In the old days, during the times when people are using typewriter, if you read a new reference, you have to start afresh, typing down the work from the point where you inserted a new reference, so that you can create some space. I'm sure you people, when you think about it, you cannot imagine how people survived. But people survived and published papers with enough references. Therefore, these days things have changed and life has become more friendly. That's why we are encouraging people. There are less and less challenges today for writing papers than they were years ago. In the past, if you wanted to read, you were supposed to go to the library for hard copies, because these were the only ones that are available. But these days, everything is just freely available on the net. Just search, just read, insert, expand a little bit, everything is done. But still, if you tell people, come up with some papers, no, this is something we can't do. Huh? So, all what has been put together so far constitutes the first draft. So that's why we are saying this entire business is very long. But if you are focused, things will happen. So far, we have the first draft. But this first draft contains everything. Because all the sections, all the illustrations, all the tables, whatever, they are just there. So when you have this first draft, you are supposed to check for style and language. Be precise and very clear. Avoid lengthy constructions and avoid verbosity or pomposity. Statements like this is the first study of its own kind south of the Sahara have no place in most articles, because there are a lot of people who like to say this is the first study of its own kind south of the Sahara. What makes you think it's the first study? It's just because you don't know about other studies. So such things must not be included. Avoid misuse of words or repetitions. When you are writing a sentence, don't use the same word many times in the same sentence. You can use alternative words by looking at the thesaurus, using the thesaurus, where it gives you alternative words, so that you can use alternative words. And also, acknowledge any substantial help that you received from individuals. Usually there is an acknowledgement section that you may wish to include. And people say it's good to include or maybe acknowledge the study population. the donor agency, if any, and if they have agreed to be acknowledged. There are some people who give money and they do not want to be acknowledged, and therefore you must ask them. Individuals who have contributed but cannot be co-authors, somebody helped you very much to enter data, but this person does not qualify to be a co-author, you may just include the name and say, I'd like to thank very much so-and-so for helping me to enter the information. Sometimes you may also wish to acknowledge institutions for providing guidance or permissions, so that at the end of the day, they seem as if they have made a contribution. Next time when you go to them, they're not going to throw you away. It's like an investment. You're trying to make an investment so that next time when you work with them, things become more smooth. Check that each reference is complete to enable retrieval. Check that each reference is cited correctly. This, as I said, no longer holds water these days because the softwares will have done this job for you. But sometimes if you are adding in some names of individuals that do not appear in the databases, then you are supposed to make sure that you have spelled them correctly. For example, the individuals whom you are including in the acknowledgement, the names should be spelled correctly. Use one style, which is very obvious. This is 8 references which you said mentally. Then you may wish to revise the article by following the instructions given by the target journal and the uniform requirements for manuscripts submitted by medical journals. This we said you can always download and read. Check the legends against illustrations and make sure they agree. I'm saying this because sometimes you can move things around in your manuscript. And the legend, which we said is a descriptive statement before a table or after a figure, they move around. Haven't you seen in newspapers people saying the regional commissioner accepting some gifts from I don't know what, and the photograph is of 3 lions fighting? Haven't you seen this before? And sometimes it doesn't happen just because people were not very careful. It's just because sometimes you can anchor a figure in a particular area in the text, and when you move the text moves, the figure stays there. And therefore, the materials that were written after it or before it move. And therefore, you have to check to ensure that the legends are in the positions where they are supposed to be. Now, reread all the papers cited to make sure you do not misquote them. We are assuming you are reading the full text articles. Don't read abstracts only. You can run into big trouble. Read full text articles, so that at the end of the day, you may see whether you are quoting them the way they are supposed to be quoted. After this, you may wish to refine your article, polish the article. This is now language. The questions of omitting phrases like observations on a study of, I don't know, whatever, use the catchy phrase, so that when people are searching your article, they can always be attracted to read it. It's like newspapers, because you are trying to ensure that your article goes through. But of course, that doesn't mean that you should put in some fancy titles that do not reflect the content. They have to be fancy titles that reflect the content. You may also be required to put in what we call a running head, which is almost 45 to 60 characters that you see on every other page. And it also saves to create index terms that are used for information retrieval systems, so that when your article is being searched in terms of in the databases, you can have the index terms. Initially, I thought the index terms are given by the editor or somebody else. No, it is you who is supposed to choose the words that you think best represent your article, so that when you search, then these are the words that will pick up your article. Sometimes they tell you to select 3 words or 4 words, depending on the agreed modalities. So when you select your index terms that are going to be used for information retrieval systems, this is your own thinking. If you think you need some help, the co-authors can always help. You must remember that you are not working alone. Therefore, you can always sit and talk, exchange ideas, and agree on the index terms, the terms that will be used to retrieve your article when you run it through the databases. So, title page bears the title, authors and affiliations, and address for correspondence. Usually, there will be a single contact person who will be the corresponding author. The corresponding author does not necessarily need to be the first author. It is any author whom you think will be able to answer questions and be able to provide information if needed by the editor. And therefore, it's not necessary that it must be the first author.
It can be anybody.
But in most circumstances, the corresponding author is the first author. Because we think the first author is the one who takes full responsibility of the article. And these are the ones who have read it maybe 15, 20, 30 times. Because they've read it over and over again. Therefore, the abstract will follow on a separate page, and you should assemble the article based on what you see in the instructions to authors. Therefore, at this point in time, we will have had the second draft. Now, when you develop your second draft, you may wish to send it out to reviewers. I'm imagining that the co-authors were working with you during this entire process. And therefore, we are not going to call them reviewers because they are working with you. And therefore, you may wish to send it out to possible reviewers so that they can look at it with a second eye. But the reviewers should be sympathetic. We are calling them sympathetic reviewers because if you send out your article to somebody who is not very sympathetic, they read it, they go through it and say, this is rubbish. What will you do? Having spent 9 months working on this work and you are very confident everything was okay, then you send it to YM. Then YM goes through very fast and said, there's nothing to report. Actually, the entire paper is useless. And you are imagining that at this point in time, as we said in the beginning, if the premises for conducting this work were valid and good, there will be something to say. And therefore, when you send it out to sympathetic reviewers, they will read it and give you constructive comments. And when you get constructive comments, you are the final decision maker. You can agree to accept what you get from them, or you may refuse to incorporate what they say. You have to weigh. There are some people who keep on giving a lot of ideas, but it's not, doesn't mean that all the ideas are good. Some of them may not even be good. So just decide. You say, according to what I've read, according to what I've reviewed, I think what I've found and what I've written is okay. So you have your stand. Some of the things you think, this is something which I forgot. Actually, it's not how the chi-square is supposed to be done. Or maybe it's not how the logistic regression is supposed to be done. Because some people, when they review papers, they redo some of the calculations to see whether they reflect actually what you're presenting. And now if they review and tell you, this is not possible. There is no way you can do this logistic regression with these numbers and get these results. Something is not right. You may wish to reconsider that and do the analysis again so that you can cross-check. When you cross-check and find out that this is okay, then you take in their comments. So consider the suggestions, but include only those you think are reasonable for your communication because you are the author of this paper. And this is the time when you have the final say, without having pathological confidence. Because some people may have pathological confidence, saying, I cannot take in any comments because I know I'm right. What makes you think you are the only right person? So when the final manuscript is ready, submit the manuscript to the journal of choice, as you determined earlier, and follow the instructions as provided. It could be by email, it could be via the respective webpage, and you have to use or follow the instructions. And as I said, these days you are supposed to register for that particular page or website. Registration is free, and you log in depending on the level that you choose. If you log in as the author, then you log in as the author. If you log in as a reviewer, you log in as a reviewer. If you log in as somebody who is supposed to provide some editorial comments or whatever, you can log in depending on the level you choose. So if you log in as an author, then it gives you a chance of submitting articles.